Okay, yeah, first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for their kind invitation of me to present, to give a talk in this important symposium. I come from the Center for Crop Systems Analysis, which has the name CSA, almost the same as NCSA, but it's completely different. Yeah, actually, Wageningen University and the Research Center has a long history in producing all sort of crop models under the leadership of Professor Keith DeWitt, yeah, who unfortunately died many years ago at a very young age. By the way, who know Professor Keith DeWitt? Okay, not many. Yeah, basically, he was a pioneer of leading crop modeling research in the world. Actually, current crop modelers in the world was trained by him in the early days. Yeah, since his first publication in the 1960s, yeah, every 5 or 6 years we have published a new type of crop models, especially those end with a cross, like yellow cross, back cross, field cross, mark cross, and G cross nowadays. Yeah, I will come back to G cross later on. Yeah, all of these models has a common feature that is related to the upscaling, yeah, from leaf to canopy to the crop. I would like to spend a few minutes to discuss about the difference between plant and crop. Yeah, most people would consider that the difference is basically plant refers to the model plant, while the crop is a plant species that has economic importance. But from a crop physiologist point of view, yeah, and the basic difference between the plant and the crop actually is the isolated plant and the crop stands. Yeah? And in this stand, you can see actually there are strong intra and interplant competitions in space, and these competitions operate in time along the entire developmental cycle. So as a result, only the harvestable product, the ground area, not by single plant at the end of the growth cycle matters. So because of this, we believe that any proposed target for crop improvement, for genetic improvement, or for plant breeding activity has to be evaluated in terms of their influence on the phenotype at the crop level. So this is a fundamental idea in the crop modeling community. So we are talking about plant in silico. Plant crops actually are almost at the terminal steps of this so-called layered biological system chain. Yeah, where we sit, yeah, it depends, of course, on the research objective. Assuming that a single attention of the research activity is at the certain biological level N. And we can see that to study the phenomena at the level N, we have to go to lower level, N minus I, to find the explanations. Otherwise, our knowledge on level N is merely descriptive. Yeah? And on the other hand, our research at the level N should aim to achieve significance at higher aggregation level, so M plus K. Yeah, otherwise, the research at level N would be considered as a trivial. Yeah, actually, this is a framework already proposed almost 40 years ago by Borchiola. Yeah, and we believe that this framework is still useful for nowadays for developing plant in silico modeling approach. Yeah, we believe the plant in silico modeling approach should be given not only by search for explanation at the lower level, but also with a proper balance with a concern for significance at higher level. So actually, in those early days, Borchiola only considered this special case. Yeah, so the three levels he considered basically is three adjoining levels in the biological chain. But nowadays, with the development of modern plant biology, maybe I is not necessarily equal to J equal to 1. Yeah? It could be more than one. So a typical example is a photosynthesis. So assuming our singular attention is at the leaf level, so to have good prediction of leaf photosynthesis, we need to go to lower level to see how CO2 diffuse into the chloroplast and what is the electron transport rate in terms of light energy, as a function of light energy supply, and also enzyme activities. Yeah, and doing the research at the leaf photosynthesis would aim to predict crop photosynthesis or whole plant photosynthesis. So next question is how to model crop photosynthesis. Yeah, as photosynthesis is a central part of any crop models. And the first approach, which was nicely illustrated in one of the posters yesterday, yeah, with the illustrations, is based on this concept as to model the crop stand as a physical sum up of the individual plants using the regression approach. Yeah. And most of the crop modelers, we are using the alternative approach, yeah, considering crop community as an identity, an entity on its own, using classical concept, such as the leaf area index, extinction coefficient, separation of sunlit and shaded part of the canopy, and also separation of the direct and diffuse light. Yeah. So in this case, some of the skip along the biological scales could be skipped, which is actually in most of the crop models, like G-Gloss model. And here it shows the relational diagram of the G-Gloss crop model, which quantifies a number of physiological processes, of course, including photosynthesis. But that is not the only one. But many others, like transpiration, respiration, nitrogen uptake, and partitioning, first between root and shoot, and then within shoot partitioning, and also some morphological development, like leaf area index, and even senescence, and so on. Yeah. So considering all the individual growth processes as a whole and as a system, and all these individual processes interact and in response to a number of climate variables and also to soil environment. Yeah. So actually, root is part of the story in crop model, but not as detailed as Jonathan has been discussed in the previous talk. So here is just some specific information about the G-Gloss model. Here, just leaf photosynthesis is best well-known Farquhar von Kammerer Berry model, what we call the FACP model, but we knew the an extended version of that model. And similarly, we knew the an extended version of the von Kammerer Fehrbank model for C4 photosynthesis. And this photosynthesis model was linked with a gas diffusion model that describes storm conductance and abundant sheath conductance, and so on. Yeah? And in terms of scaling up to the canopy, we knew in the DePaley Farquhar approach, sunshade approach, to extend the calculation from leaf level to canopy level. Yeah? And here you can see that the tempo scaling up to daily total was based on either on Gaussian 5-point Gaussian integration over the daytime, and or summing up of the hourly volume, yeah. And this approach also applies to other physiological processes. And the mainframe of the model actually using time step of 1 day, so that computationally is feasible for the entire growing season of the crop. And in the next part of my presentation, I would like to show the examples of using this type of crop model to assess the impact of proposed improved target, like improved leaf photosynthesis on crop productivity. And actually, there are two options to improve leaf photosynthesis. First is exploring the natural genetic variation in leaf photosynthesis. The second is a genetic engineering approach, yeah, which has been active in several mega research programs. And first, it's about the natural genetic variation. This is based on our former PhD student, Junfei Gu, who developed an integrationline population from a single cross between two rice cultivars, Shenyong 265 and Haoglao. Yeah. And with this integration line population, he mapped the QDLs for air marks, the light circulated photosynthesis, and the related gates when this plant will grow under the field environment. And you can see that there are some spot where it is responsible for genetic variation of a single gate or a couple of gates. Yeah, there are also some hot spot where it has a fundamental impact on a number of gates, such as this one on the chromosome 9. Yeah. This is a mapping under the field conditions. The next step is to the confirmation of the identified KDL using independent experiment, which was conducted in the greenhouse. And in this population, actually one integration line, by the way, IL stands in the integration line. This line numbered 161, which have the almost same genomal background as the recurrent parents, Shenyong, but only one position was integrated with the donor parents, Haoglao. And actually the difference between this actually is entirely due to the integration at this region. And you can see that the measured photosynthesis was consistently higher in this genotype than the recurrent parent, either at the flowering stage or green feeding stage or under stressed environment or well-watered environment. Similarly, similar story was found for the PS2 electron transport efficiency. Yeah. And actually the QDL effect was found for the entire CO2 response curve and the light response curve, as showed here for the difference between this integration line and the parents. Yeah. And actually, he also did the measurement for a number of integration lines, 11 integration lines plus two parents. Yeah, and the difference in the genomal background among these lines was shown here. And using this measurement on the entire response curve, it was possible to parameterize the biochemical parameters in the FACP model. Yeah. And then once these parameters were estimated, the genetic difference in these parameters could be mapped on this on the genomal positions. Yeah, individual parameters include those electron transport limited and low Pascal or gas diffusion limited parameters. Yeah. And the next step is to see the genetic variation that has been shown at biochemical parameter level can be scaled up to the leaf level, canopy level, or entire crop level. And here you can see this is the individual FACP biochemical parameters. Yeah. And this is the minimum of the whole population, maximum of the whole population. This is population mean. And here then you could calculate the percentage of genetic variation across the entire population. And you can see that the genetic variation was found to range from 20 to 50%. Yeah? And then if we use these individual parameters to calculate leaf photosynthesis at a low light level or high light level, and we obtained about 25 to 31% genetic variation. And further, when this was implemented in the canopy photosynthesis model, we obtained 25, 26% of genetic variation. And further, go to higher level, crop level, over the entire growing season, then you can see we get the genetic variation for total biomass production in either temperate environment, Beijing in China, yeah, or tropical environment, Los Banos in Philippines, and we get similar the genetic variation of 28 to 29. This indicate that the genetic variation found at the fundamental biochemical level can be scaled up equally, yeah, to the crop productivity, to the crop level, indicating that exploiting the natural genetic variation in leaf photosynthesis could be applied to improve the crop productivity. The next step is about all sort of engineering avenues to improve photosynthesis, to improve C3 crop productivity. Here we examined, for example, the possibility of improving mesosphere conductance, GM, improving opacity specificity factor, SCO, and combining of the both. And then the next one is the C4 possibilities. Here we consider a stepwise approach. Yeah, first is a C4 enzyme introduced, including the higher enzymatic capacity per unit of leaf nitrogen, and then CO2 glanzin anatomy based CO2 concentrating mechanism from C4, and then combined C4 enzyme and CCM. Yeah. And the next avenues was based on the cyanobacterium CCM, yeah, and basically consider the difficulties of introducing the glanzin anatomy. So this one has been considered as an alternative approach to introduce the CO2 concentrating mechanism in the C3 plant. And the last one is a little bit hypothetical. Yeah, just combine the complete cyanobacteria CCM with the C4 higher ECN. Yeah, this ECN actually is quite, because normally people would consider the higher productivity of C4 plant is due to the CO2 concentrating mechanism, but that is not the only thing as shown in this measurement. The measurement was measured at a very high CO2 level, which means photodisplacement also visually does not occur in C3 plant like rice, but the photosynthesis in C3 plant under this high CO2 level is still lower than what you see in the C4 plant. So that's why we consider this extra jets for the, yeah, okay, great. And here is all sort of the light response curve for all these avenues, and you can see the enormous amount of impact at saturated light level, but less differences in the light limited level. Yeah, and here is the is a modeled canopy photosynthesis as a function of also light intensity, but at four different canopy size. Yeah, and again, you can see enormous amount of improvement in canopy photosynthesis. But this relative difference changes with the change of canopy size. But if you calculate the crop productivity in comparison to what you get for the default C3 plant, then you can, by the way, this simulation was done using long-term weather data. Yeah? And you can see all these different avenues. So the first three actually has only marginal improvement compared to the default C3. And C4 avenues actually only when the complete C4 mechanism was introduced, you get more than 20% of increase. Sometimes you get higher, above 50. And the most significant part was obtained only when the cyanobacteria CCM and C4 ECN was combined. Yeah. Then it always get high, more than 50% improvement advantage. Actually, this was done for tropical environment. Simulation was also conducted for subtropical environment and temperate environment. What I want to show, this is one of the last few slides. Yeah. What I want to show that actually inducing photosynthesis improvement mechanism, not only primary photosynthetic light use efficiency was improved, many other gears were changed as well, like light interception, respiration, partitioning to root, and senescence. And so it would be nice to examine whether those so-called pleiotropically changed gears also has influence on the final predicted biomass. Yeah, and here you can see that actually, not only, of course, the primary change in light use efficiency has the most significant effect, but other changes, secondary changes, like light interception, yeah, and partitioning and so on, also have big influence. So indicating that all these individual processes or gears are interconnected. So actually, if we look at those avenues from number 4 to number 9, actually these avenues are the combination of three elements. First is CCM strength, yeah? Second is LP cost for this CCM, and the last one is the magnitude of ECN. It would be nice to see the relative importance of these three elements in improving the productivity. Actually, all of them are very important. Yeah. Only see is that when the underwater limited environment, the CCM becomes slightly more important. So just come to the conclusions, and we can see plant. First, I would like to emphasize that plant in silico modeling should aim not only for the explanation at lower scales, but should also aim for the significance at global scales. And current crop models can already be exploited to do some primary preliminary assessment, in silico assessment of the impact of suggested target gears, like improving photosynthesis on the final productivity. And the GLOSS-based simulation revealed that the transformation for improved leaf photosynthesis might have a lower impact than the hoped for due to some secondary effect on the other gears. Yeah. And only when multiple photosynthetic elements are all improved, then there's a possibility for the maximum benefit. Yeah. With this, I would like to thank you for your attention. Sorry for taking a few more minutes.